Good evening and welcome to Winternachten, International Literature Festival 2021. My name is Fiep van Bodegom and tonight I will be the moderator of Writing Climate Injustice. Live from Theater aan het Spui in The Hague. This year, the theme of Winternachten is It's Up to Us. Tonight's program is the first in the thematic line of We Still Rise, a series of programs on activism and literature. Tonight we will talk about climate justice and more specifically also climate injustice with the writer Alexis Wright and four poets and performers. Those who demand climate justice use the term to frame the climate crisis as a crisis that is not merely an environmental or natural phenomenon, but rather an ethical and political issue. One in which those who suffer from other injustices, such as colonial exploitation and racism, are even more vulnerable to the consequences of a rapidly heating planet. Climate crisis is not a recent crisis or disaster, and it affects and has affected already vulnerable communities disproportionately. If you have any questions, I would like to refer you to the Facebook group or the chat underneath your this screen. See the link in the chat. And this is a place where we will share reading recommendations and links, show notes, and where we encourage you to share your thoughts and engage in the discussion. My first guest tonight is Alexis Wright. She is a member of the Wanji Nation of the Southern Highlands of the Gulf of Carpentaria. Wright is professor of Australian literature at the University of Melbourne, author of the award-winning novel Carpentaria, A Tale of a Town in Crisis, and the tensions escalating around the establishment of a mining site. Next, she published the novel The Swan Book, of which we will hear more in our upcoming conversation. You will hear more. Wright has published three works of nonfiction, Grog War, Take Power Like This Old Man Here, and most recently, Tracker. All accounts of the ongoing Aboriginal struggle for justice and self-determination. We'll start with the interview that we pre-recorded this morning because of the time differences. Maybe to start with a very simple question. How did you become a writer?
Hello, Fiv. Hello. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge that I'm talking from the Wurundjeri and Boorong country of the Kulin Nation in Victoria. It was called Narn, which is Melbourne. And pay my respects to their elders, past and present, and emerging leaders. And also wish to honour my countrymen and elders in the Gulf of Carpentaria, the Wanyi Nation. And also pay my respect, and I always say this on any thing that I do, is that I honour the oldest library in this country, and that is that this the library of our stories, which is kept in the land, seas and atmosphere of this country. I also want to thank the organisers, Tinky, Julie, Joel and Alan, for organising for me to be part of Winterhaven for 2021. So, Fifa, the question was, how did I start to be a writer? Thought about? Yes? Look, I come from a background, and a lot of us do. We're brought up in our communities and families to take responsibility and to be responsible for our traditional lands and country and culture and people. And I was doing a lot of work for a number of years, and as mainly in research and with a number of issues that we, huge issues that we take on in terms of land rights and native title, almost everything to try to bring some justice to our people. And my background became, I think, as a very young woman, that I had probably a little bit more education than a lot of our elders. And they wanted the young people, you know, like us, to get educated and to work for our people. And they gave us a lot of responsibility, and they, with that, they expected, us to work hard. So my work has been mainly in research, and I just felt that one day, and I like listening to stories. You had a very strong story telling grandmother, and I spent a lot of time with as a very young child, and I just felt that one day that I would write, and that grew from. Got to the stage where I found some time to write, and I was and it grew from there.
Yeah, so you wrote a number of books, historical accounts, Grogwar, but also, of course, a lot of oral history that goes into the historical accounts. But you also choose for a few works to do a clearly a fictional angle, or their fiction. Mm-hmm. So what is for you the difference there?
In terms of the work that I was doing, it was research into particularly rights and constitutional rights and what Indigenous people are doing across the world, and trying to bring some understanding in our own communities about what we could do and couldn't do. But I also, had a love of literature, and I'd read writers from all over the world when I thought about writing, and I truly do love, literature, and I felt that it's a very strong way in telling the story, and to getting points of view across, and in some ways to tell a better way to tell the truth, because when you're doing nonfiction. And I found when I was doing Carpinteria, which was my second novel, I could have written that book as a nonfiction book. Would have been a different book altogether. But that book grew out of some huge issues that we were having in the Gulf of Carpinteria, particularly on our traditional country, Wanyu country. But it also affected all the other nations, Aboriginal nations across that area. And I could have written a non-fiction book, and it really, what happened there really deeply affected us. And there were points of view on either side. It caused a lot of a disruption amongst families, and those scars are still with us. And we got criticised put on by the whole country, from the federal government to state government to local governments, criticising us for taking a stand, for not wanting to have a multinational mining company, biggest type of mine in the world, built on our pristine lands. And so it was very close to home. And like I said, there were people for and against mining, and I could see both points of view. But I also felt that I didn't have the skills to write a non-fiction book about what happened there and without being sued. We've got very strong libel laws in this country. So, and fiction is a better way. And I also wanted with that particular book, write a book that was as authentic as I could possibly make it to our traditional country and the spirit of the country, spirit of the people, and that was the best way to do it. And it was difficult, but I'm pleased that I did it as a fiction book.
Yeah, and also 10 years after the book was published, Carpentaria, you were asked, who are you writing for? And your answer then was, in an interview in The Guardian, I concentrated on the way our people speak to country and each other. In that way, it always felt as though I was writing a story to the old people about the complexities and bravery of our world today, but also by linking the past and the present in this way, I was bringing the ancestral realm into a story of all times. And I would like to ask you, is that still who you are writing for? Or and also as a follow-up question, what has been, for example, the response of a younger generation of your people to your work and also from all over the world, I imagine?
Mm-hmm. Well, particularly with writing Cut and Terrier, it really felt like I was writing a story to the ancestors about, how we are today, what we were doing and how we feel about things, about ourselves and about what we're doing. Because it did feel like that, and it can feel like that when you're sitting alone for 6 years writing a book like that. Who people always ask, well, who are you writing it for? Who's your audience? And to me, it felt like I was telling a story to the ancestors, and to talk about who we, what we are doing, without how do I put this? Without our own stories and about how we feel, and which is a lot different to what you might read in the newspapers or what governments might say about us, we don't have our stories there. It could look like a totally different thing and of who we are, and it's very, very, very important that we tell our own stories. And we have our own narratives.
Yes, thank you. So it's both for ancestors and outsiders, in a sense, as fiction. Mm. Yeah. Move to the later novel you wrote, The Swan Book. That novel is filled with landscapes, the lake, the desert, the overgrown city, plants and animals, especially birds. And I also see some birds in your background hanging on the wall. So there are, of course, a lot of swans, both in literature and real swans, but also brolgas and owls, very talkative ghosts of the dead, genies, and distorted weather patterns that also give all kinds of feelings. Could you say something about this importance or emphasis on the non-human in your work, and how, is it related to a style like magic realism, or do you see it coming from these stories of the ancestors? How do you work with that?
I was looking through a essay I wrote about this, writing the Swan Book. I never published that essay. I was looking through it today. And it's an essay I wrote probably a good 10 years ago now. And and one part in there, I talked about how I felt the swans were a gift from the ancestors. I knew nothing about swans when I started writing the book, or when I started doing research for that book. And I don't even know where the swans came from, because we don't have swans in our traditional country in the Gulf of Carpentaria. It's they're more a southern bird in Australia, but I had to put a lot of thought into that novel on how to do it, and I wrote it at a time when there was even more denial about climate change in this country and across the world, and so I was thinking, that book was written for a lot of reasons, but climate change was definitely, you know, part of it, and putting it 100 years, in the future. I had to think about, you know, how to construct that novel, how to make it work, how to make it, you know, people want to read it, and it was because it, you know, there's a lot of things happening in my mind about what I think about and what I feel about, and at that time when I was writing, you know, started to think about writing it, it was at the time when the Australian government was you know, criticising really heavily the world of Aboriginal people, or trying to take over all the, you know, the small gains that we've made here on rights, on land rights, and some degree of self-determination, or not a great deal, but it was always wanting to erode those, whatever we'd gain. And so that was an issue, and they took a decision to bring in this emergency intervention in the Northern Territory, which was really to send in the army and take over those communities, and to accuse Aboriginal people of not loving their children, and because you know, or so-called, you know, you know, abuse, or blowing up, you know, all sorts of reasons, and not looking at some of the problems that you know that has created from long-term intergenerational poverty. So I was thinking, what the government did there was such a backward step. You know, it was taken us back decades in thinking and the small gains that we'd made. So I was thinking, what would happen if we take this into the future, 100 years in the future? We keep going this way, and we keep denying also, you know, climate change. We keep denying these things. We keep locking people up. You know, Australia had a great idea, you know, great incentive of locking up boat people. So we got climate change, and once say we got a climate change future where there's, you know, millions of people are boat people that are, you know, who are going to be they're not able to live on their country anymore, their lands, and may have their country, you know, taken over by other people. And are not going to be permitted to be, you know, to not going to be accepted.
Maybe, sorry to interrupt you, but maybe for the viewer who does not totally know where the book is about, shall I give a very short summary? So the book is 100 Year in the Future, Australia 100 Year in the Future in the Swan Book, and we follow the lives of two very different Aboriginal descendants, the neglected and abused Emily Wake, or Oblivia Etheline, and Warren Finch, the golden boy of his people, who is expected to get things done politically without betraying his culture. The continent is overtaken by ferment, pollution, and political opportunism. And Europe, meanwhile, is underwater and has fallen apart. Some of these Europeans make it to Australia after an arduous and mythical sea journey as boat people, as you mentioned. And still they are blatantly racist and feel morally superior. And as you explained, you were thinking about if sea level is rising, where do all these people have to go and how will it look? But my question would be, in how far is this so different from how Australia is now? So it's in how far is it a very big step for 100 years? Or even in how far is it so different as 100 years ago?
Well, Australia is, I think, you know, from the time that the Swan book was published or even thought about, I think Australia is, many people, a lot of people in Australia, and as a lot of people across the world, you know, are recognising the issues of climate change more than they have before. But it's but I still see that there will be, you know, a struggle for people, you know, who for Indigenous people, for people of you know, of a small countries, you know, in the Pacific. There's already people, you know, who have rising seas lapping at their door, and with erosion, and on small islands and in the Torres Straits. And I think the, you know, the racism that exists across the world, you know, towards towards what it's called the other, that will continue. I mean, we're looking at a climate emergency that possibly, you know, the world, it will, you know, with global warming, at four, you know, warming by 4 degrees across the world, you know, within the, you know, at the end of the, by the end of the century, and what that means, and to millions of people. But I don't know. I looked at the Swan book a long time ago, and that was just trying to figure out, you know, and just trying to understand what the science was saying then, and trying to paint a story, you know, about the facts, you know, that they were presenting, and then, you know, and just surpassed even my, you know, my imagination, and I think, you know, and I wanted to just say that I have an essay just published just recently in the monthly in Australia, and I thought in there that you know, I wondered how, you know, how we could create a poetry and a literature so grand that it breaks through the nexus of indifference, the violence, forgetting, to make sure these catastrophic weather events never happen again in the so-called Pyrocene era of the collective human suicide or omnicide of the Anthropocene. And I just felt that, you know, perhaps we can't find the answers yet, and but, you know, how we tell the stories, you know, for the future. And but I think they have to be radically different to what we're doing at the moment. I think, you know, we have to expand, you know, our thinking and concerns, you know, past our personal address. And our personal concerns, and but we will do this because you know, climate change is already, you know, radically, you know, expanding our imagination more than ever, you know, before, and surpassing, you know, what has been our literary concerns.
So you say you advocate for poetry to help foster this change or this realization of the emergency. Some are only now in, but others have been in for a long time. So the research for your book, I would fear you did that 10 years ago or maybe more. Would you now add, or if now you would be asked to say something about 100 years in the future, would there be an element that is really different that would be added?
Um, if I would have done the Swan book differently.
No, not the same. If you have to, like, a scenario for over 100 years, but we are now 10 years later, are there elements you think that came to your attention in the past 10 years of which you think this is of really great importance, or this is a change or a trend you see?
Well, I think there's been there's so many things that have happened in terms of global warming. You look at the huge fires that we had here last year, this time last year, and it burnt 46 million acres or 18 million hectares, and in fires in America and other places in the world, and everything is catastrophic. All these climate change events, and so I think our response has to be, these are huge things, and our response has to be ethical, and we have to take, pay attention, and to expand our thinking, across the world, and try to figure out how do we do this in literature. I mean, I don't think literature is going to, change the world, but we have to be part of the narrative, the world narrative about, what we do in the future. And
you see that also as a duty as a writer, to take on these issues, even though you don't know what the effect will be or is or even can be?
I think it's a duty of a writer to be attentive for what's happening in the world. Mm-hmm. And what's happening in the world is huge. And so it's really hard work. It's hard work to try to understand what's happening in the world, and you look at COVID as well. That's huge. We've got to figure out ways of responding to these things if we're going to be relevant as writers.
Yeah. It's also a duty as simply humans, even before writers, maybe. Could you maybe also tell us then a little bit about what you're working on now, because you're continue writing?
I have a very busy world here, a very busy life. So I do a lot of non-fiction writing. I get endless. You've asked before about the response to books like Carpenter and the Swan book. It's an endless response, and I want some other people to write these things so they can get all these requests as well to talk about all these things. Mm-hmm. And because it seems that people need to be having these conversations. And that's what books do. They start those conversations. And so I seem to be having these conversations all the time. But I am writing a book. I started it probably a good 6 years ago. All my books seem to take six or years or more. So this is a book called Praiseworthy. And it's set in the Aboriginal world here again. But it's also looking at, climate change, and living through a pandemic, I think. Mm-hmm. Because I'm interested in what we do as people, and particularly some of the very, very strong Aboriginal leaders that I know. One in particular is my countryman, Gungalita countryman in the Gulf of Carpentaria, Murrindu Yenna, who I wrote about in the New York Times last year, traditional fire burning and fires where fires should be, not fires where fires shouldn't be, burning the country and these Superstorms.
Yeah, so I think we have to, I'm sorry we have to end, but I think it's very good to end with that books start conversations and that also continue to start conversation even years and years after they've appeared and maybe the writer has finished them in that sense. Thank you so much for your time and for being here and also starting the conversation for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Fiep. And I hope you all have a very good festival. I wish I could be there.
There was Alexis Wright, who gives the writer the very great task to write to break through the nexus of forgetting. For the second part of the evening, we have asked four writers and activists to perform a piece in response to tonight's theme, writing climate injustice. They have used a fragment from the Swan book that is laying here as inspiration for their performances. This morning, we also pre-recorded Wright's reading of this fragment, which is coming up now.
There was a story about a sacred tree where all the stories of the swamp were stored like doctrines of law left by the spiritual ancestors of a place so sacred it was unthinkable that it should be violated. Old people said that the tree was like all of the holiest places in the world rolled into one for us. No wonder she went straight to it. Funny thing that. The tree watching everything, calling out to her when it saw some people had broken the law. Something will happen to them. This ancestor was our oldest living relative. We're looking after the memories, so it had to take her. When the girl was found, though, the tree was destroyed by the army on the premise that this nexus of dangerous beliefs had to be broken to close the gap between Aboriginal people and white people. These stories, scattered into the winds, were still about, but where? That was the problem now. It made us strong and gave us hope, that tree. The kinspeople of the tree had believed this since time immemorial. Really, all that was left behind of the story were elders and their families whose ancestors had once cared for the old, tired and withered, bushfire burnt-out trunk of a giant eucalyptus tree through the eons of their existence. They were too speechless to talk about a loss that was so great. It made them feel unhinged from their own bodies, unmoored, vulnerable, separated from eternity. They had been cut off. They called themselves damned people who felt like strangers walking around on their country.
Our first performer is Chihiro Geuzebroek, a filmmaker and decolonial environmental justice activist. She traveled to Bolivia for her climate justice documentary, Radical Friends, an activist coming-of-age story. She's former campaign manager of the political party Bijeen and co-founder of the Climate Liberation Bloc. Chihiro is currently working on an indigenous futurist screenplay situated in the US when the first indigenous president comes to power. Recently, she wrote the theme song for the Shell Must Fall campaign. Chihiro will be performing Damned People.
We are damned people. Repressed, restrained, restricted from flowing through the land we belong to. Oh, so many measures inaugurated this post-apocalyptic fish tank life, structures preventing us from swimming against the current counterclockwise. Invasive roads and dams that choke arteries of common good were just the beginning. Feet were forced into shoes that did not fit, and our revolutions to restore common practices of reciprocity and decency were held at gunpoint by colonial ways of scorching earth and our humanity. We are damned people, but we are not dead. We weave our broken fingers back together into a fist, and while they are working to define us out of existence, we are busy not losing our place in this world. By listening to the swamp and the beyond for guidance in wholesome unity and diversity against the odds. We refuse toxic states and weaponized education that operate like lawnmowers and leaf blowers, enforcing eliminatory policies, policing towards monopolies for concrete boroughs that borrow with no intent of ever giving back, normalizing settler refusal to respect. When assimilating hustle becomes a means of subsistence, dissociation is the only way to endure in this rotten system. Still, we cannot translate our thoughts into languages of hierarchies and binaries and linear lines and settler refusal to respect life and their ways that enforce doctrines of manifest destiny, always in denial of our intersubjectivity. Speechless, we struggle to break the spell of being killable and deemed ripe for extraction, sick of sanctioned loneliness, eroding our immune system, grooming us for retraction. But one day, something, rather than nothing, will break these dams and make them fall. Maybe through collective sabotage, maybe a controlled demolition, maybe an act of mystery, or perhaps by the unceded basin's own volition, a reminder to revere we are still here. Dams will fall and water will gush and wipe out structures of this warfare of attrition. And while TV news reporters speak of the flood as a disaster, invader, enemy, we know that this flash flood brings medicine to those wishing to live in ecological reality, bringing balance, caring for country, regenerating bush, nourishing natives, and we as liberated people learning to reconnect will rise without reservations into processes and precious futurity that nurture all our relations.
Thank you, Chihiro, for your impassioned contribution. And in a minute, we'll listen to Benjamin Froh, a rapper and word artist who once described himself as a philosophical rapper who creates hip-hop music. His second album, Behave, criticizes the Dutch just be normal mentality amid soulful beats. In 2019, Froh released the EP In the City about identity, gentrification, love, and spirituality. In a world where money and status are paramount, followed in 2020 by the EP I Love Them. Now he will first perform his piece Truth and Time.
I heard that history is only a generation away. And they'll be facing the same problems we're facing today. If we don't come up with a plan for transformation and say annihilation is near if we don't awaken today. But what I see is a violent nation in hibernation, denying traces of violence that we see on display. Within contemporary discourse, we miss forceful arguments that never had a voice behind the doors of our parliaments. We might have representation, don't mistake it for change. for it is not a correction of the mistakes that we made if we don't recognize the systems that have made it this way. If we still ignore the folks that are trying to say that the books that write our history are trying to save faces, male ones, pale ones, Europeans, we buy the tale and bite the tail of the history we believe in, and we stand there in awe of the mystery that we're seeing and fail to recognize it's only history repeating. We're too proud. We've got our heads stuck in the clouds, talking about something that we know nothing about. And our lack of knowledge, it resembles a drought that we will face if we hesitate to figure this out. Because we can pass a lot of bills, but don't mistake them for change. If it's just a variation on the same old refrain, if it's just an adaptation of the play that we made. Because you can read about history in the papers today. And I heard that history is only a generation away. And it'll be written by the kids that we're raising today. And whatever they see is what we choose to put on display. Pictures of the revolution on the instant replay. Is it a story of progress or of constant decay? Is resolution just a hard conversation away? Is our fear of confrontation why we patiently wait for a fruitful train of thought that's just a station away? Are we on the right track, facing frustrating delays? If history is only written by the colonizers, that means half of our story is told by ghostwriters. So it seems like we're choking on smoke with no fire, and whoever brings water is called a polarizer. But the future is only a generation away. And if we don't want them to face what we're facing today, then we really need to make a transformational change. How can you count on your kids to correct your mistakes if you don't correct the ones that your ancestors made? On the shoulders of the giants that we stand on today, but on the backs of the oppressed is where the boulder is placed. And their silence tells a story that cannot be erased, of a loan on the truth that we can never repay.
Thank you, Benjamin Froh. I will be talking with all the performers later on, but next up is Sanam Sheriff, a queer poet and artist from Bangalore, India. In 2018, she graduated with a BA in creative writing, and she spent the following year traveling the globe as a Watson Fellow, exploring storytelling as a form of healing. She's currently an MFA candidate in poetry and poetry editor for The Spectacle magazine, while working on her first full-length poetry collection. Sheriff was also a guest of the Winternachten Festival in 2018. Now we'll watch Sanam's video contribution.
My name is Sanam Sheriff. I'm a poet. I'm from India. And I'm excited to share with you my contribution to the Winternachten Festival.
What we now call the trees were once called the gods, their kingdom a green and honest song. Their angels adorned the wings of birds, the hooves of horses, an onyx braid at the water's edge. To know them, we must remember what the colors made in the earth's eye, what the bulbul spoke in the ghazal's ear. Fresh water blooming between this bloodwork of bark, these brooks of branch. Each leaf was a green and honest name, a drop of time in an endless clock. Gods of ants, gods of winds, gods of the gold sentences in a summer sky. Our eldest mothers knew this worship, bent their knees, treated temple whatever touched life, knew everything touched life, treated everything as prayer, fastening their faith to the season's name. They learnt the language of the lakes, the angles of light, songs to be made between wind and wood, fires to be stoked inside a pregnant night. Gods of women, gods of womb, nine moons growing full beneath their breasts. Our eldest mothers fed the land as they fed their kin, nursed the flowers, collected the rain, understood the circle of things, how even beauty blooms in decay. Where now there is plastic, once there was soul, a container of light for the body's grain. How it crinkled, how it filled, how when the time came, it made a boat of the evening breeze and swam to a land we have tried to name. Some say heaven, some say afterworld. Some know the gods in the inches of things, the halos tied to blades of grass, the pearly gates of winter's gown. It's winter here. Outside my window, monopoly, free markets, an imperialist shade. The river spits up the factory's waste, the forests, the low jungles cough, entire seasons of smoke. Even breathing has to be bought here, even dying is something to afford. Bodies piled high in a corporation's grave. How blood feeds the green in the pockets of men, how power feeds the greed. There's a crying baby in a cardboard crib, there's a bleeding calf in a slaughterhouse mill. There's the burger its mother will make with her meat, a dollar at McDonald's, the only meal the mother of the crying baby can reach. Don't we understand the cycle of greed? Don't we know the currency of crime has never been need? Dear gods of forgiveness, gods of grace, I don't know when we forgot, but I know that we did. I've seen the maps in the white man's hands, the imaginary lines he pulls across earthen flesh and ocean's blood. I've learnt the names he's given to life far larger than us. Gods of knowing, gods of seed. Who dies for my sins today? Whose hands dig the footprint I leave on the world's glimmering skin? Whose life pays for this comfort I'm in? Gods of justice, gods of root. Help us to remember what we already know. The ocean salting our lover's eyes, the forests filling our mother's lungs. Put back in our mouths your green and honest song. Let our fingers sound the strings and let our choices water our wings. Gods of mercy, gods of love. Here is the fist, the size of heart. We know the path is paved, an upward slope. The artist's art, to play its part, must build a house of hope and hope.
That was a lovely contribution of Sanam Sheriff. And the next and last performer we'll hear tonight is Leena Norms. Leena is a literary video essayist, poet, and critic from the UK. She became well known with her YouTube channel, which features book discussions, poetry readings, and personal vlogs. In 2019, she published Doom Rolled in Glitter, a small collection of poems about the high and low lights in the life of a 20-something, friendship, love, and facing climate change. Now we will watch her poem, The Farmer's Great-Granddaughter.
Hi, my name's Leena Norms. I'm a poet, and for the context of this poem, it was inspired by the prompt and how it links to my family history. My granddad was born into a family of farmers and went back a very long way. So this is me imagining how I would feel if that farm hadn't fallen out of the family and I was the person it was left to, knowing what I know about the climate crisis. So this poem is called The Farmer's Great-Granddaughter. I stand and inhale the fields that once were forests, lean on the kissing gate that puckers up to meet the blood under my wrists, tucked inside a hand-me-down anorak. A rearing head that sniffs out the ancestors, concertinaed inside my chest, their shadowed bodies clearing trees, meaning well. An attempt to tuck the future in at bedtime, pacing out plots and filling them with pigs and painted paddocks with the hooves of tomorrow. The pride of coming down from trees to tiled floors, pulling up homes as if on strings to make the world dance for us anew. I reach for them, but knowing better, extend my arm further, pluck out forefathers who didn't farm but foraged, who hadn't learned to hoist flags yet. I long to swing pendulum legs from trees and camp out among them until all of this is over. stoop below skies of pitch and hum in a key that doesn't have a name yet, belly to the heavens, howling at what hangs there, which is, I see now, the promise of the view from the kissing gate. A dream to consume that leaves us now, in turn, devoured, teeth and all, and although I'd like to turn a heel, I won't quake to take my place in a line of staunch traditionalists who don't live to save face, but to sow well, to empty barns and stuff them with days, open the fields and fill them with wild minutes, turn the soil back to itself, for who am I to wave a tartan in the face of fortune? Not the kind you can earn or buy, but the fortune you meet whilst leaning on a gate, who winks as he passes through.
That was Leena Norms, with whom I will talk later. But first, here at the table are Benjamin and Chihiro for a conversation. And I start with a few questions for Benjamin. Do you think too explicit activism is a danger for your work or even for commercial success? Or should an artist not care about that at all?
Well, I think it's difficult for an artist not to care at all, because in the end you have to pay your bills, you know. But no, I think it's definitely like something that is difficult to balance. And in my personal experience, I've noticed how my being vocal on all sorts of different political topics has, you know, created this image of me of an angry rapper when, you know, if you come to a show of mine, it's quite the contrary. And yeah, I mean, that I sometimes feel it's a disadvantage to be seen as an activist musician. But, you know, I don't even consider myself an activist in the sense that I'm just trying to tell a story that, you know, that touches people. And like, the content might be political, but that's not why I'm doing it.
But it doesn't keep you from these topics, or does it?
No, I think, I mean, the stuff that I write about, it's something that comes from a place of something, you know, being a topic that I care about, and of seeing people in my community around me struggle with certain things. And I try to write about those struggles. So it's, you know, obviously sometimes it's going to touch on some political subjects, but it's not like, it's not my focus to tell a political story or make a political argument in any way.
So you would say it's simply part of everyday life also?
Yeah.
You also write in your text, we've heard before, we might have representation, don't mistake it for change, which is an interesting remark with the elections in March coming up. What do you think would bring change, if not elections, or should we not see it so positional?
Well, I mean, first of all, I'd want to say that, like, it's not that I don't trust democracy or you know, to get any misunderstandings out of the way. Like, I think elections and elected officials are a very real way and an effective way to get change made. But yeah, it's that line I was referring more to. You might have a woman in the right position or a person of color in the right position, but if the mindset is still patriarchal or colonial, then that won't, you know, that won't mean a lot. It won't make a as big of a difference as, you know, if you have a completely different mindset and set of values. But to answer the question of what besides elections can incite change, I think it's you know, definitely like public pressure and direct action and people doing things, you know, people getting out there and making their voices heard in a, you know, in a constant struggle. Yeah, not just every 4 years when elections come around, but.
So it's much more than only going out to vote.
Yeah.
I thank you. I have a few questions also for you, Chihiro. You are many things, and also on many levels, it seems, a filmmaker, an artist, and a public speaker. But perhaps a common factor in your work is that you're an activist. What do you think eventually mobilizes people?
So, first off, there's a difference between mobilizing people and organizing people. So for mobilizing people, it's often enough to have a sense of injustice and urgency, whereas to organize people, which is long lasting and that it sticks together, I think there has to be a vision of justice and a relationship, community. So yeah, I see a lot of people come into activism with urgency, maybe anger or despair that drives them into, we need to do something. Whereas organizing is a lot of levels deeper in, where you actually have to work together, and that coalition building is a trust building endeavor.
But I would say it's always the one step comes first. You first have to be mobilized to even feel the urge to organize, or do I see that
for most
wrong?
People. For most people. I think for myself, I've always had, like, I think in case of indigenous life, there's the phrase, our existence is resistance. There's no such thing as a non-political indigenous life, just by the fact that you exist when the colonial forgetfulness implies that you're extinct, is a political act to remind people of that you exist.
Ah, okay.
So that's just going there, comes, opening up that.
I have to think about this. So it's all, even before you do anything, it's already maybe not an act, but a political existence, let's say.
Yeah, and to keep reminding people that you exist, and not just as an individual, but as a people, that you're not extinct and that you're still demanding land back, and not just as the land itself, but also the governance and the way of just really organizing society in a different way with a different cosmovision.
Yeah, this is also a recurring theme in Alexis Wright's work, this self-determination and just like showing that you're still there and have rights and demand justice. You wanted to add a little bit about your performance just now.
Yeah. Thanks. When we got the piece, the extract, I immediately knew that I wanted to work with the damned people, because in so many ways we are contained into reservations, but also contained into collective memory, kind of erased. And in all the excitement when I was just performing, I erased one of my own couplets. So I wanted to share it here, because it has a lot of meaning of that erasure and undoing it. So it's, we, the damned people, we have been cut off from the ocean of collective memory, making this temporary occupation seem like eternity. Our archives are underground, unattainable, yet they remain, and all that was buried will sprout again. If only we can blow up these dams. Damn fake borders, bloody orders, this so-called civilization built on supremacy and separation. Imprisoned from the inside, I feel small and incompetent. Still, there is a glimmer of memory reminding me on whose shoulders I stand. Ancestor. Ancestor, all I do is to hear you speak. My friend, help me remember, research, wake from susto and dream again. I am so damn trapped in the schisms, this architecture of objectifying my kin into oblivious nothingness.
Thank you. Thank you. You already told me that you recognized a lot in the work, and it made you start writing right away.
Yeah, it came out like this. I don't think I can claim authorship over it. It just, like, I think a lot of what the extract embodies is stuff that I find in the work from Kim Tolbert, who also speaks about this colonial forgetfulness, or Suzanne Méthode, who wrote a beautiful book on legacy. And just remembering, like, it's not just the memory, but it's about weaving yourself into a community that is told to be dead, just like a lot of species and a lot of landscapes. But to me, it's a source for my activism, to know that regeneration continues, and I'm still part of a lineage that goes back. So I think when we go back to the organizing and the mobilizing, for me, there's always that sense of justice, of being in relation and knowing that we are nourished and always have a duty to feed back, put ourselves back in the circle of healing.
Yeah, and maybe I think for you it's very self-evident, but for others maybe it's something that is relatively new. And this is a question for both of you. Where can members of the audience start if they are new to climate activism? I don't think anyone is new to the climate catastrophe that's going on, but the idea of what can I do? Do you have any ideas of how did you start out yourself?
I think, you know, there's the easiest thing that you can always do is see what's happening locally in your area, what groups are out there, and what see what they're doing, and just see if you know activists are always looking for more help, so you can always reach out to an organization near you, and ask what you can do, and just start by going to a couple demos and just being there.
Feed into that. When are the demos in this COVID reality? In March is always a busy month because you have the National March Against Racism, the Women's March, and the Climate March, and now we also have the elections. So there's a lot of coalitions where you can feed in with the climate coalition. We with Code Rood are busy, but of course also Extinction Rebellion, Milieudefensie, TNI. A lot of partners are there, and then I think it's a very useful. People think with activism like that's just being on the street with mm-hmm. a sign, but a lot of it is, you know, who's taking care of the press statements, who's going to be there to. And normally bring soup or bring food. Now with COVID, that reality is different. So also think about where does your talent meet the need? Maybe you're a photographer, then you have a different role maybe in activism than if you're a lawyer and you can be behind the scenes in the legal advice. So that's also expanding the spectrum of activism that you have a skill and it's going to be useful for activism. So. Even if you don't see yourself in the street, connect with the groups because we need skills on all fronts.
Yeah.
Okay, so actually everyone can contribute.
Yeah, and they have a moral duty to heal. We're in the age of healing. You know, if you don't see the signs around you, there's a lot of sickness around here. We need healers of all shapes and forms and sizes and skills.
I would have loved to continue, but we also have to go on because we have two other speakers waiting for us in the UK and the US. I won't see you again, Chihiro. We will see you later on, Benjamin.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Hey, Sanam. Hello.
Hi.
Good to see you. You're in the US at the moment.
I am, yes. Yeah, thank you for having me here.
I wanted to dive right in and start with that very powerful last line of your poem, which fits in nicely with the festival theme, It's Up to Us. The artist's art to play its part must build a house of hope and hope. Can you reflect on the part and that the artist must play for you or in this piece?
Yeah, I thought that being online would help my stage fright, but my heart is in my mouth, so I will try to be up there.
It is live, it's still on stage, yes.
James Baldwin, a writer that I have looked up to for a long time, he has a speech titled The Artist's Struggle for Integrity. And in it, he says, quote, the poets, by which I mean all artists, are finally the only people who know the truth about us, end quote. And I think about what that means for me as an artist and an artist in community with other artists. And this truth that he's talking about, I think to me is what I believe to be the cord that connects all of us as living beings. And for me, that's our ability to feel. And so when I say hope in that last line, I also mean imagination. I think imagination and hope are crucial to each other. And I think that we live in a time where our imaginations are being stomped and controlled by the powers that be so that their force can be maintained. And I think each artist has a medium, right? A sculptor gives us form, a writer gives us language, a painter or photographer gives us image and color. But when I really think about what is the role that we play here, for me and myself, I think it's one, to lean into that well of feeling, of experience, that truth that is in a way intangible. And the real work for me comes into doing the work of translating that into something that can be collectively experienced by us, that connects us and makes us closer. So for me, before there's justice imagined. And so I think that for me as an artist, part of my role is to give to imagination a form so that what has been forgotten or doesn't yet exist can be made possible. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, thank you. Like so, through imagination, also a prefiguration of something mm-hmm. new, maybe. Thank you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which you also already mentioned James Baldwin, but which maybe other art or artist has have given you this kind of hope?
That's a tough question because the list is it's a living list and it's manifold. And maybe I will stick to language because that's where my study has been. When I think of novelists like James Baldwin, I also think of Arundhati Roy, Toni Morrison, Akweke Emezi. And when I think of poets, I think of Joy Harjo, Khalil Gibran, Mahmoud Darwish, Patricia Smith, Audre Lorde. And then I also think of the women who raised me, my mother and my grandmother and my aunt. They kind of built for me my first house of hope, you know. And I think what I mean to say is that all of these people in their living and in their selfhood and being alive have created for me at all the intersections of my identities and how they're opposed by the world. Just they made me feel possible and they made a just and loving world feel possible. And I think that's the house that I like to live inside in that world. Yeah.
Thank you. I think it's very hopeful that you can mention that you mentioned so many, both artists and people in your life. And now for maybe already the last question, you have written that queerness is a lens of liberation, and this is something we have not discussed in the program before, but do you think that that lens of queerness also has a role to play when it comes to climate activism and justice, climate justice?
I think that's a great question, and I think my answer is yes, because when I think about queerness, what it does is it rejects the boxes that are drawn around us to separate us from each other. And so these binaries, man, woman, girl, boy, gentleman, lady, and the rules around them, they create the other, they create an opposing force, and they create these boundaries that we're not allowed to cross. And I think what queerness does is it transcends those labels and those laws, and it says, I acknowledge the ancient truth that we've inherited of our oneness and our connectedness and the relationship of our soul selves. And maybe our only border is our bodies, and even that can be crossed. And I think about this in line with climate activism and climate justice in terms of respecting like our shared consciousness and the connectedness of all beings is so inherent and important to that. So as a queer person, when I'm rejecting gender roles and gender norms, I'm actually rejecting hierarchy and the systems that hold that hierarchy in place. And I think that's so integral to environmental justice because we are under this flawed notion that humans are somehow above the rest of nature and can use it and exploit it. And so I think the queer movement, the climate movement, artists in general, we're all fighting for a freedom that is fighting for our right to like love and nurture and protect each other and value that over profit. So I do think we're on the same side of that fight.
Thank you. So do you think in a sense that queerness also de-emphasized like the focus on the human as the hierarchical, like on top of a pyramid or like in charge of the world? You think that also it deconstructs that notion?
Mm-hmm. Because it deconstructs our notion of what a human is. If someone says a woman has to be this and a man has to be this and they have to love each other, it's rewriting that script. And so I think it's rewriting our relationship to all living beings at the same time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think we are at the end of this segment, and I will talk on with your colleague. Thank you. And I hope this was your second time, and I hope we'll see you again.
Me too. Thank you so much.
Hi, Leena.
Hello.
We saw your poem earlier today, and I also have a few questions for you, of course. You have a series on YouTube called A Guide to Positive Panic, and the name of your poetry zine is Doom Rolled in Glitter. Is it safe to say you like to cover extreme emotions, doom and panic, in a softening layer of glitter and positivity? And why do you think that contradiction helps to get a message across, especially in regards to the climate crisis?
Yeah, well, I think what's interesting in your question is that like there's this idea that those two things contradict each other and they don't naturally come together. So we have this, the name of the zine is actually kind of not a joke, but like there's a phrase in the in English that is, I won't swear on camera, but poo rolled in glitter, which is trying to make the best of a bad situation.
You can swear.
So it's that kind of like idea that just because maybe you're in a hospital ward and you're waiting to die, something funny can't happen, or there are little moments of joy within that. And I think my journey with kind of climate anxiety and learning more about the planet was this sense of doom, this kind of unsurmountable, ununderstandable. And again, like I think when we read stuff like I read The Uninhabitable Earth, it was my real like coming of age in the climate panic. Even the numbers were so hard to contemplate that I felt this sense of almost irrational doom, because I think there's lots of ways that we can be really hopeful about the climate. And because we are only like one person, and especially when we have grown up in an age of individualism where we believe that we'll be able to understand everything on our own and it's up to us as individuals, it can feel very overwhelming, when actually I think when we see ourselves as more of a body of humanity, we do actually have a lot of the skills and are equipped with a lot of the skills to really change things and build things in a different way. So yeah, that's kind of the idea of this positive panic thing. And I think it's also kind of important because there's a lot of information on the internet that's like you can Google it and be like, here's the bit where we just talk about the climate or we just talk about eco stuff, and the people who are really panicking won't be watching that because they won't be Googling it and they don't want to engage with it, or they're people who are in denial. So for me to integrate the positive panic into sillier videos I make and different kind of stuff, and also even in the climate change videos I make, I make a lot of jokes, I am silly with it. I think it's that easing of panic that enables us to really enact what we feel and the kind of real facts that are in front of us. That's the kind of way I approach it, I think.
So you're also saying like pure panic doesn't help either to mobilize anyone.
And I think also it's not completely accurate. Like because we consume so much news and because the news is so sensational, we're often shown the most visually scandalous or or dramatic images that aren't necessarily a representation of everything that's happening all over the world and all the good things that are being done and all the very mundane, slow progress that goes on. So I don't know, there's a book called Factfulness that maybe a few people watching have read, but there's a fact in it that says, like, in the last 20 years, the proportion of people living in extreme poverty in the whole world has halved. And I never see that on the news. That's something that's never talked about because it's happened so gradually and because it doesn't get clicks. It's not, in some ways, to the kind of news agenda, it's not exciting. But I actually think there's a lot of capacity for change. And when people say, like, oh, it's impossible, we can't do it, nothing's going to happen, it's kind of almost a little bit disrespectful to all the amazing experts who have been working on this for generations, you know? It's like there are people who are really working towards realistic change. So, yeah.
So there's also hope, and we have to hold on to that too, is what you're saying.
Yeah, definitely.
So maybe you already mentioned a few titles, but maybe to stick to the contradictions, can you give us some recommendations of climate-related books or maybe videos or documentaries that of which the urgency made you panic? And could you give us also fewer one of these House of Hope these points of hopes or authors that give you hope to stick to Sanam's words?
Yeah, definitely. So I actually wrote down one that I've read and one that I'm currently reading for each of those, because I think my learning is constantly in progress and it's something that I'm constantly trying to learn more about. So I wanted to talk about the stuff I'm currently reading as well. So for the stuff that really did make me panic, one of them was We Are the Weather by Jonathan Safran Foer. He is a fiction author predominantly, but this is a non-fiction book he's written all about the climate. And he talks a lot about comparisons to the instinct for suicide within a lot of humanity, and this idea of not wanting to save ourselves, like struggling to find a reason to save ourselves. And he talks a lot about the denial that a lot of people had during the Second World War about the Holocaust and the people who didn't really believe it was happening. So it's really hard to read, but it's actually really beautiful, and the end is quite hopeful. But it is he really tackles this idea of nihilism and, you know, is humanity worth saving? Why don't we think we're worth saving? Is that part of the problem? Is that why we're not really doing anything about this? And then I'm currently reading A Terrible Thing to Waste, which is, the subtitle is Environmental Racism and Its Assault on the American Mind. So it's a conversation kind of about bodies and racism when it comes to the climate crisis, but also about how that is assaults mental health of a lot of people. So that's by Harriet A. Washington, and it's really good so far. I really recommend it. And then stuff that's hopeful, again, I just talked about Factfulness, which is a guy called Hans Rosling who dedicated his life to studying the realities of humanity and what's getting better and what's getting worse. And that fact I quoted is from his book. And it was really interesting. And he goes through all the different ways that we misrepresent facts in the media, especially around factoids. So facts that are given without context and without an expert present. Those things are really hard to digest if you are given them in the wrong way. And then there's also a book that I'm currently reading, which I'm going to butcher this name because it's Dutch, so you can tell me it's wrong. Rutger Bregman. Humankind, A Hopeful History. I'm really enjoying it at the moment and it's giving me a lot of hope. And I think it's important to ground your hope in facts and not make it part of a denial mentality. So that's been really helping me through.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Maybe one little step further. You told me earlier you talk a lot about climate anxiety, and I don't know if this is a very negative take, but I see that as in between the manic and the panic is like a very big field of anxiety. What is it that you advise for or against that? Or what?
Well, it's a term that's kind of like doesn't really have an official medical kind of diagnosis, but is a term that's thrown around a lot when we talk about this. But I think it's an interesting thing to talk about because it's a way to talk about how the environment and what you've learned about the environment might affect your mental health. And I think that even in without the element of that, just it being a good thing to directly address people's mental health, it's also pragmatically really important for the movement, because anxiety can be really debilitating and can stop people from taking action and actually have a really detrimental effect on the future, as well as just and in the care of the individual. So there's so much to say about that. I guess I can't really unpack it all now, but I think it's really important to recognize when you're in a state of, your body is reacting in a state of panic. Because I think, again, when we read these kind of facts, it can really, we can have a physical reaction, just in the same way that if you stand on stage and lots of eyes are looking at you, your body and the evolution of your body is telling you that because loads of eyes are on you, you're being hunted, that you're lunch, you know. And in the same way, when it comes to reading about the climate crisis, it's really hard not to feel in your body that it's coming right now, and for that to have a kind of shutdown effect on your brain, and then you not be able to think calmly about what the best thing is to do, and also think about all the things and how far we've come as humanity, really, and how far there is to go. So yeah,
thank you so much. We for the viewers, they can see all these lovely books and titles you mentioned in the show notes or in the chat underneath. Thank you so much, Leena.
No problem. Thank you.
We'll have a closing song to end this inspiring evening with music from Benjamin Froh, If the Revolution Never Comes.
This is all wrong. I shouldn't be up here. I should be back in school, on the other side of the ocean. Yet, you all come to us young people for hope. How dare you? You have stolen my dreams, my childhood, with your empty words. And yet, I'm one of the lucky ones. People are suffering. People are dying. Entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction, and all you can talk about is money.
If the revolution never comes, we're probably gonna die from carbon dioxide being pumped into the sky. The fall of mankind, the rising of the tide has been predicted many times. We shouldn't be surprised when the water starts to rise and there's nowhere left to hide. Polar bears reside at the edge of their existence. Maybe it's all too little, too late, and the struggle too great, and it just doesn't make a difference. Waking up every day, discover the world is still the same. Corporations running the game, people are praying for something to change. Maybe it's cause we never really gave a fuck, or thought that it would go away once we had made a buck. Or cause once we had it all, we said it ain't enough, cause we all forgot that we were made of love. Yo, maybe we all forgot what life was all about, and the will to make it rain left the fields in a drought.
You are failing us, but the young people are starting to understand your betrayal. The eyes of all future generations are upon you. And if you choose to fail us, I say we will never forgive.
Yeah, and if the revolution never comes, and the 99% keep on working for the ones who run and make tons while we fight over the crumbs, the battles will be fought up in the slums over any resource that's not enough for everyone. I'm stocking up on food, water, ammo, guns, cause I'll probably have to fight my own kind if we don't manage to win the battle in our own minds. And the end transpires, the sky is on fire, cause life is just a hoax or a joke, and I'm a liar, and cream is supreme. Bow down to the sire as the choir lifts wings, violins play a requiem for everything that was and turned to ex-being, as they breathe their last breath with their chest heaving. But the world is turning, the system's burning, it's concerning not to learn a thing from what we're seeing.
Thank you, Benjamin Froh. And again, also thanks to all our speakers of tonight and to you, our audience, for tuning in. I invite you to stay up to date about the upcoming events in the theme We Still Rise during the Slow Festival coming year, where the conversation continues. Good evening.